about our world of possibilities. Do your usual biscuits have the thick continental chocolate of Balzen's Choco Star and Choco Leibniz? Are they as crumbly as Balzen's blackberry or apple crumblies? Are they as deliciously crisp as Balzen's original or new chocolate hit? We thought perhaps not. So why settle for anything less than a Balzen?
Now there's a TV magazine that's like all these put together. TV Plus for 45p.
Next on Four, Without Walls begins with a personal view from opera critic Tom Sutcliffe, a reappraisal of Benjamin Britten. Last week's Without Walls, about the recent auction of artworks owned by Polypec International PLC, said that Mr. Aziel Nadir had gone bust and that the furniture and works of art were being sold to meet his debts rather than those of the company. Channel 4 accepts that Mr. Nadir has not been declared bankrupt, nor was the auction held to sell his personal property. Channel 4 unreservedly apologises to Mr. Nadir for any misunderstanding that may have arisen. Books in Half an Hour looks at the mistrust that exists in some quarters between Western and Arab society. First in tonight's Without Walls, a personal reassessment of Benjamin Britten.
The fishing village of Aldborough, home and inspiration to Benjamin Britten, England's finest 20th century composer, or so it's widely claimed. In fact, much of what he wrote in the sycophantic closed world of Aldborough was anemic and loveless, spiritually dead long before he was buried here in 1976. Before Benjamin Britten was 40, he was already saddled with cult status, hailed by his most ardent supporters as an English Mozart, no less. Now, 14 years after his death, he still claimed to be the top British composer of the century. But is he?
1945, the war was over at last. There was a sense of relief all round and a determination to build a new world. Musicians, too, responded to the feeling. Sadler's Wells Opera in London reopened after 5 years of darkness, but instead of an old favourite, a Verdi, a Rossini, or even Merry England, the choice was for a brand new work by Britten, just 31 years old. During the 30s, Britten, like Henry Moore, had been a promising newcomer. In the event, he produced the first really successful English opera for 250 years. Peter Grimes made an immediate impression.
I wrote for tickets, not thinking I'd probably get them. Well, I did, and I went, and it was a wonderful occasion. It had a feeling of renaissance, of a complete rebirth of British musical life after the war.
The opera told the story of an ambitious Suffolk fisherman who combined paranoia and a touch of sadistic pederasty with an almost poetic vision. This persecuted, hated outsider living in a narrow society was a peculiar kind of hero. Britten was unveiling an original and highly personal operatic agenda which explored new and uncharted territory.
Britten took
these very strange themes are the result of his unique birthright, his personality. He took what was important to him, what was vital to him, and it's one of the sort of marvelous miracles that they moved out to have universal appeal.
Peter Grimes was one of the pen portraits in a poem by George Crabbe about that quiet little fishing town, Aldborough, on the Suffolk coast. Only 100 miles away from London, but in spirit three times as far. In the 1940s, there's no doubt Britten found inspiration here. But his remarkable technique went way beyond these very English roots, achieving a European sophistication.
We recognize that Benjamin Britten was a master of the theater. In a way that the great operatic composers have been, whether it's Mozart or Puccini, they had an unerring feel for the atmosphere and dramatic intensity, and Britten showed this remarkably in Peter Grimes.
Grimes was the first of four important stage works written by Britten in the post-war decade. All of them, Albert Herring, Billy Budd, The Turn of the Screw, about misfits, victims of society. As with the stories of E.M. Forster, librettist of Billy Budd, closet homosexuality was a crucial element in the psychological landscape. The remaining 20 years of his life were an anti-climax. After this extraordinary start, inspiration faded and creative energy dried up. Britten's music became colder, more tightly knotted. That's not the view you'd find in the press. Critics have helped build a Britten myth and are sticking to it. As early as 1952, he was perversely bracketed with Mozart and Mahler by his supporters. Yet he failed to produce any great symphonic work, and apart from the Prince of the Pagodas, few orchestral works of stature. Even when a sort of aesthetic anorexia set in the 60s, he got nothing but praise. It's time now to see the man as he really was. I want to examine why he failed to build on those early operatic achievements. Born 1913, son of a Lowestoft dentist, he began composing at the age of five, a child prodigy predestined by his mother as the latest in a line of greats, Bach, Beethoven, Brahms, and now Britten. His schooling was standard middle class.
I had a rather conventional upbringing, but I went to a rather strict school where one was made to work.
There may have been skeletons in his home background. He told a few close friends there was something terrible in his past. And in his works, he returned again and again to the theme of lost childhood innocence. Certainly, he grew up with a shy, uptight personal style and a touch of the puritanical stiff upper lip. For a time in early adulthood, he seemed to have the potential to break that mold. Influenced by his teacher, Frank Bridge, he became a pacifist. He wrote music for left-wing theatre and films, and of course supported the Republicans in the Spanish Civil War. He fell in with intellectuals like Christopher Isherwood and W.H. Auden, the poet. He also learned, like them, what it was to be homosexual. In 1939, he followed Auden to the USA in what later would have been called draft dodging. He tried his luck as a composer, without much success, for 2 years, camping out with an indulgent family on Long Island. He shared the house with Auden and with the tenor Peter Peers, with whom he fell in love and formed a lifelong partnership. But Britten felt unwanted as a composer in America and yearned for Suffolk. In 1942, soon after America entered the war, Britten and Peers got a passage home. Auden, who believed artists had to cherish their bohemian inclinations, wrote a farewell letter to Britten in January 1942, warning him against the fatal attraction of order and respectability.
Dearest Ben, I can't make myself believe that you are really leaving us. I've been thinking a great deal about you and your work during the past year. As you know, I think you are the white hope of music. I think I know something of the dangers that beset you as a man and as an artist. In art, goodness and beauty are the result of a perfect balance between bohemianism and bourgeois convention. Bohemian chaos alone ends in a mad jumble of beautiful scraps. Bourgeois convention alone ends in large, unfeeling corpses.
For middle-class Englishmen like you and me, said Orton, the danger was to lean too much towards a deadening bourgeois conventionality. Britain's first test back in war-torn London was facing a tribunal as a conscientious objector. Would the dedicated pacifist make an appropriate stand? Another pacifist composer, Michael Tippett, was soon to be sent to Wormwood Scrubs for refusing to work as the court insisted. He ended up sewing mailbags. Britten had a bourgeois horror of the disgrace of a prison sentence. He also had eminent patrons. He found there was an easy option for performers. With Peter Piers, he could give recitals to the troops. At the old mill he'd purchased at Snape near Aldborough, he settled down to see the war out and compose. From then on, Britten actively sought the respectability Auden warned against. He and Piers formed a very proper couple, and his influential friends helped to secure their acceptance at the very highest social level. The Earl of Harwood, the Queen's cousin, was married to the daughter of Britten's publisher. At 40, Britten was a kind of court composer. In 1953, he was asked to write an official opera to mark the Queen's coronation.
In a conversation on holiday with him, we talked about national operas. I was put up to go and talk about it to Buckingham Palace, to the Queen's advisors and to the Queen, and say, look, this would be a wonderful thing to do. If we could get it set up, which meant in conjunction with Covent Garden, which was the obvious place to do it, would it be acceptable? And within a very short time, the answer came, yes, it would.
The opera Gloriana was duly staged before an exclusive stuffed shirt audience. Britten was made a companion of honour by the Queen. Britten benefited from a special relationship with the royal family throughout his life. The Queen herself came and opened his new concert hall at Snape in 1967.
And I have much pleasure in declaring open the Maltings Concert Hall and Opera House.
But did the kiss of respectability dampen down Britain's inner fires, as Auden had warned? Certainly, despite his reputation, Britten told friends he felt outdated and artistically washed up. He tried to get back to his essence, increasingly drawing on a rather buttoned-up religiosity. Britten turned to the church, not to formal religion in any sense, but to the womb-like environment of discreet pieties that has always accompanied middle-of-the-road Anglicanism. Here at Orford, he launched into a trio of church operas with a new brainwave recipe mixing plain chant and monks and Japanese no-theatre and percussive Balinese timbres. Curlew River, the first of the church operas, picked up the lost boy theme of the turn of the screw. But the radical agenda about social outcasts had given way to a sanctimonious tale about a madwoman searching for her missing son. The keening, curlew-like music is thin and repetitive. The fire of the earlier operas is entirely missing. This is the music of a man almost neurotically anxious to be inoffensive. It desperately lacks commitment and relevance. Proof enough, it seems to me, that Britten was now producing exactly the emotional corpses that Auden had predicted.
Over an hour, 70 minutes music is derived from a single plain chant, and there's no independent harmony in the piece anymore. Where he wants to thicken out the textures, he simply sustains the notes of the melody he's using. Some people felt that by the 60s, and once he'd started using these limited techniques, that something of the generosity, the bloom, if you like, of the early music, the poetry even, had gone out of it, and it had become a little dry.
I feel the church operas themselves don't have a real pulse. It seems to have lost a kind of raison d'etre of all music, which has an ongoing pulse. It's a kind of as you were music. Come in when you like music.
Why did Britten pursue this pious vein? He was never a churchgoer. He needed the protective colouring of religion, the respectful setting insecurity demanded. Even when promoting pacifism, he contrived a neutralising ritual by framing Wilfred Owen's passionate war poems within the Latin Requiem Mass.
The music is always unique and instant, and as such, it's honest. But the actual philosophy behind it, I think, can be bourgeois, and simply because he wished, I think, very much to be part of a respected part of the kind of English middle class society that he was part of.
The Anglican Church was a very convenient, and probably still is, a very convenient way for certain people to hide. It's much easier now. Perhaps Britten living today wouldn't have hidden the fact that he was homosexual the way he did then. Being ensconced in the countryside like that, the Anglican Church was a way, I suppose, of appearing very respectable, and nobody would question him or talk about what he was doing.
Britten's instinct for lace curtain conformism was reinforced by fear of ridicule. Gloriana had been called the Twilight of the Sods. And most of his life, homosexual relationships were criminal. But as Auden feared, respectability cramped his art. There was a second concern in Auden's letter of 1942.
Wherever you go, you are, and probably always will be, surrounded by people who adore you, nurse you, and praise everything you do. Beware. You are always tempted to make things too easy for yourself, to build yourself a warm nest of love by playing the lovable, talented little boy.
By 1961, Benjamin Britten was England's leading composer, and his musical partnership with Piers was ripe for satire. Dudley Moore's depiction of Little Miss Britten brilliantly sent up both the Piers nasal wail and Britten's affected style of writing for voice and piano. Britten certainly didn't appreciate the honour of being a target. He couldn't bear criticism.
What was Britten's reaction to bad notices?
Illness. Self-induced illness, which had lasted a couple of days. Just terrible distress.
For all the plaudits he won, Britten remained chronically insecure, always nervous about the quality of his musical ideas. His fear of hostile reaction became almost a phobia. With Gloriana, he'd been attacked for presenting Elizabeth II with an opera about Elizabeth I's amorous indiscretions in her dotage. It proved a turning point.
I think it turned him off the great public occasion to a very considerable degree. I think he thought that music did much better in outlying areas, the micropolitan syndrome, not the metropolitan syndrome. I think he preferred that.
Britten and Piers had started their own little music festival at Aldborough in 1948, when they didn't get on at Glyndebourne. Now the Aldborough Festival became central to their lives. Most Britten premieres henceforth were at Aldborough, and Britten could rationalise his retreat there as following the traditions of William Morris socialism.
The idea which sprang out of the arts and crafts movement at the end of the 19th century, the idea which Holst and Vaughan Williams and composers of that generation believed in, that one must write for amateurs, one must be useful in the community, one must write for every level of ability. And I think the whole experiment at Aldborough was an attempt to put this political and aesthetic point of view into practice.
Aldborough's Jubilee Hall and various local churches suited Britten's liking for thin, churchy sounds. Above all, he had his own audiences. Britten could write happily for children and amateurs who knew how to be grateful. He composed Noy's Flood for school children, famously creating the first raindrops of the deluge on a set of strung-up teacups. But Aldborough had its dangers, a haven isolated from the radical intellectual milieu Britten enjoyed in the 30s in London.
I always felt, for example, about Glyndebourne, that it needed a stage door that went out onto a filthy street, and that there was a box office there which had some significance for its functioning. The theatre must be part of that demanding everyday life.
Britten's problem wasn't just the risk of ivory tower escapism. Aldborough fed his tendency to paranoia.
No. Sorry, Liz, you're getting louder already. Do keep it quiet, please. Absolute.
At the court of King Benji, criticism and disloyalty were not tolerated. Artists were expected to admire Britten's novelties or keep their traps shut.
It was a bit dodgy. If you were in favour, fine. But people did get nervous, you know? Because Ben could turn against you on the strength of a mediocre performance. Artists were always in a great dither. Have you been invited to the party on the last night? And if you hadn't, it means that you'd somehow failed and you might never be asked again.
Aldborough, which had been so inspiring and evocative for Britten, now turned into a mean-spirited prison. Over the years, the casualty list of those not invited back grew and grew. The official explanation for the departure of so many glossed over Britain's increasingly petty-minded vindictiveness. Those who lasted the pace at Aldborough were total devotees and acolytes, like Imogen Holst, who sacrificed a composing career of her own to sit at the master's feet. But did this increasingly sycophantic atmosphere matter?
We know he didn't like criticism, but at the same time, I think as the sort of artist he was, the fact that almost everything he said was law and that all these people jumped to his command must at the same time have fed this insecurity and this feeling that he might dry up at any time.
They gave him what he wanted, which was a feeling of being loved in spite of anything. He could do anything, they'd still love him. Whereas in fact, I think had there been a little more criticism about, he might have become a little bit braver in those terms.
The decline in Britten's songwriting is widely admitted. In my view, his songs were always a mixed bag. Britten preferred to set great poetry, not because he could meet the challenge, but because he needed the support. His snobbery about texts meant he could use a Purcellian technique to string together picturesque phrases. But now, the music didn't just miss the spirit of the poetry, it detracted from it.
That's a work in which you can hear the musical schemes churning round and round. You can hear where every note comes from. One really does feel that he fails because he's cast out so much of the brightness of the music and so much of the liveliness. He fails in that case to catch the sort of visionary side.
A curious bleakness settled over Aldborough. Britten's need for bourgeois respectability and paranoia about criticism undermined his composing. The most serious decline was in opera. The barren harvest of church parables was followed by Owen Wingrave and Death in Venice, two works that leave many people cold.
So often, for example, in Mozart, one feels that at some moment, which may be in quite a trivial situation, perhaps part of a comedy, the music lifts the experience to something beyond that immediate dramatic situation. And this is something which I experience rarely with Britten. One doesn't feel that transcendental quality.
It's significant that this is the quality that can be found in the operas of Michael Tippett. Britten's near contemporary was not just a pacifist and homosexual like Britten. He was also never bothered about respectability or what others thought. Tippett's work may lack the neatness and technical sophistication of Britten, but it's imbued with a glowing, passionately affirmative humanity. It mixes Indian mysticism with Jungian psychology, an attack on capitalism with support for women's lib. Risky, but it succeeds.
There has always been a gritty intensity about Michael Tippett's music, which I think gives it a strength and this transcendental quality which is the mark of a great composer.
By contrast, where's the universality of Death in Venice, Britten's last major work? Britten's final opera is adapted from Thomas Mann's story about an aging literary lion sexually obsessed by a beautiful boy. It's really the last of the church operas, this time written from the confessional box. Auden noted Britten's attraction to what he termed thin-as-a-board juveniles. Death in Venice seems like a private testament, a self-advertisement, a bid for pity more than a campaign for liberation. There's not much for the audience to identify or empathize with.
As far as I can see, Death in Venice is a bit of a cop-out. I mean, from Thomas Mann as well, what they're basically saying is there's a sexual feeling which they cannot immediately admit, and they will call it beauty or call it something Greek in order that the real feeling won't be too difficult for them to accept.
And with a work like Death in Venice, which was his swan song in a sense, it is about his life with Peter Piers and it's about what he was. I don't think that it really mattered at that point, because everybody knew and everybody accepts homosexuality in society, at least in the arts world. And I don't think that it's particularly moving in that sense.
Ben's music, I'm turned to ice with admiration for it. But it doesn't hit me in the belly button.
Britten hid himself away in a world of personal fears, secure from the threat of critics and new ideas. An industry has grown up around his music. People with an investment in his mythical status would not take part in this program. They would prefer to enthrone him as a great European composer. In truth, his talents were miserably distorted by insecurity. Vaughan Williams and Elgar, whom he so despised, will continue to outshine him.
In the face of fearsome competition, information technology can be a very powerful weapon. Anderson Consulting can help you find the best way to unleash it.
Pick up an around-the-world lucky passport at McDonald's. There are millions of food offers available, and holidays to Italy to be won.
Here at Vidal Sassoon, we often work with both mousse and hairspray. Now you can use just one, new Vidal Sassoon style and finish.
On wet hair, it styles like a mousse. Try it, Jackie.
On dry hair, it holds like a hairspray. Feels great, right? New Vidal Sassoon style and finish.
Whoever you fly, wherever you fly, you can get delayed. Where we won't delay is helping you get a message to someone back home. You never know. It might just save a little heartbreak. Air Canada. It's a breath of fresh air.
Wipe the floor.
Come on,
wipe
the
floor. Out.
Dog's got muddy floor.
Get out.
Come on. I'll do it in no time.
Not with that. You need Flash.
Okay. Race you.
No contest. Watch, Flash will shift this greasy mess.
That's not fair.
If you want to finish faster, you can use Flash next time.
What next time?
Flash cleans greasy grime in half the time.
Dad.
You can put a stop to your bad dreams with a new current account from the Woolwich. No wonder you're with the Woolwich.
You know it too.
What's this? Very ultra. Non-bio, we can't recommend that.
But it's a technological breakthrough. Leaves nothing on buyers behind.
Well, leaves them behind, eh?
Yeah.
Look, all I want to know is, will it out-clean the leading non-bio at low temperatures on tough stains like...
tea.
Beetroot.
Beetroot.
Ah! I knew it wouldn't shift the beetroot.
No, this is the Fairy Ultra one.
It did shift it.
New Fairy Ultra. At low temperatures, all it leaves behind is other non-bios.
Christopher, what are you doing staring at a copy of the Radio Times? Where's the telly?
Sold it.
What?
Don't worry, Mum. The news agent tells me that all we need to get BBC, ITV, Channel 4 and even satellite TV is this new Radio Times. Say we don't need a telly.
Well, you still need a TV to get all those channels. Yes.
Sinclair, he's asked me to go abseiling.
Boy, he doesn't waste any time, does he? Well, did you tell him you'd never done it before?
Mate, I tried. He reckons being the all-round sportsman, I would have no trouble picking it up. The only thing they'll be picking up is me at the bottom of a cliff into a bucket with a shovel.
Just tell him you don't want to do it. I mean, it is a free country. Don't. It is a free country.
Yeah, but food isn't. And I've got a mortgage, mate. There's no way I can say no to Sinclair.
Well, that's your decision, but if it was up to me, I wouldn't let it scare me. Look, the thing is, he's a top sportsman and he's rich. He's going to have all the best equipment, isn't he?
You don't think they're going to be satisfied now that we've started paying, do you? They're never going to stop.
I didn't know what else to do, Jim. I can't stand the thought of losing Reese.
Well, obviously, I feel the same way, but we can't allow ourselves to be blackmailed over it.
Maybe if we made it clear that this is absolutely the last payment.
No. No, no way. Those two are not going to get one more cent out of us, no matter what the consequences.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, I was dressed for work and now look at me.
Temper, temper. Lee, you have a very large wet splotch down the front of your shirt.
Are you rat? Matt, now I'm going to have to go and get changed.
I don't care. You shouldn't have made me do the dishes when it wasn't my time.
Oh, come on, it's running late and I thought you'd help.
No excuses. That's the door. You'd better get the door.
No, no, I'd rather get you.
Oh, now, see what you've done? You put a big wet splotch on the wall and that could be Hillary home. I mean, hi, you forget something, Mum?
Eh?
Doesn't matter. What you got?
Oh, I've got a few designs for your bike. Do you want to have a look?
Yeah. How many did you do?
I did three, but I really wrapped in one of them.
Right.
I won't say which one till you've had a look.
Okay.
How's it going, Nick?
Good. You're all wet down the front of the
shed. Yeah, I know. It was an accident.
Ah.
So what are those?
Designs for Matt's bike.
And they're beaut. Mate, you're a genius.
Didn't you know that?
No, I mean it. No, this is great. Is this the one?
Yeah. Do you like it?
Yeah.
Well, let me have a look.
No, I don't think so.
Why not?
Well, I don't think that you should be allowed to see the design until it's all finished.
Yeah, and even if I have to wear a blindfold while I'm doing it.
Oh, come on.
No, not until it's all done, okay? Now, how long do you think that'll take?
Well, I thought you'd be a bit toey, so I've got everything set up in the garage and ready to go.
Oh, good. Well, let's do it.
Okay.
Well, actually, I might drop it on the way to work.
Now, listen here, Miss Nosey. If you try and see it before it's entirely finished, I'm going to get Nick to paint your name and your face all over the front of the bike.
Oh, you would not.
I would too.
I don't know what Des is so scared about. Abseiling would be great.
In my day, they called it mountaineering. It terrified me even then.
Oh, come on, it'd be fun. Tearing down cliff faces on a piece of rope.
Not for me, thank you very much. And we'd be a lot happier if you didn't think about it for the next few years, wouldn't we, Beverly?
Sorry, what?
I said I think that Todd's a bit young to take up abseiling.
Oh, yes, definitely.
Anyway, I would have thought you'd be too busy making your first million.
Have you, man?
Oh, from your gardening jobs. Or is that all by the by now that you're back with Melissa?
How'd you find that out?
When I see a young man running around the house doing all this housework without being asked, I know that something's going on. Now, am I right?
Yeah, it's terrific, isn't it?
Yes, it's lovely. But I hope you won't let your gardening customers down.
No, well, I haven't got any jobs for the weekend anyway. Do you mind if I pop out now? I'm meeting Melissa down at the coffee shop and...
I'll fix all of this.
Yeah. Bye, Jim.
There. I take it we're in love again.
We are.
Well, thank goodness for that. Oh, every time he's in love, I seem to go through a lot of aftershave. You have to buy me some more, darling.
If we make one more payment to Deborah and her boyfriend, we'll be doing it forever.
I see. So it's a case of, sorry, kid, the repayments are getting too heavy. You'll have to go back.
This is not a money issue, and you know it.
If we don't pay, then they'll have Reese taken away from us. For God's sake. Helen, tell him. Helen?
Well, I'm sorry, I can't, Beverly, because I believe that Jim's right. Pay them the money, and you'll only prolong the agony. Please don't make that mistake.
So what do we do?
Well, I understand this Adam character is going to call you to set up a meeting.
Yes?
Well, go ahead with it. Let me know when and where. I don't want to lose this little boy any more than you do. Please, just trust me.
So do you reckon it's going to look as good on the bike as it does in the sketch?
Better, mate. Yeah, heaps better, because everything will be bigger. And we haven't decided on the colours yet.
Yeah, I'm just not too sure about this red down here. Kind of reminds me of Sharon.
Sunburned scarlet. How is she?
Oh, not good, not good. Still staying inside complaining about the fact that we won't give her any sympathy.
What does she expect? We tried to tell her.
Women.
My car's out in the street. What's going on?
Well, we thought you were Lee.
Huh? No, we're doing some work on Matt's bike and we don't want Lee to see it until it's finished.
Oh, nice machine. I had one like this when I was a young bloke. How's it go?
Good, yeah, it's good. It'll go a lot better once I get bigger jets on the carby.
Yeah, you're probably right. You ever done any work on cars?
Oh, some. Wouldn't mind doing some more.
What he means by that is the job at the workshops in Lincoln.
Shut up.
Well, it is, as a matter of fact. I've got to say that the money's not up to much.
Oh, well, that's okay. I could use the tools and stuff to work on the bike in my spare time.
Yeah, I don't see why not. Want to start next week?
Yeah, fantastic. Thank you.
Which leaves us with one problem. Who moved my car?
Not
me. Wasn't me.
So we had to get the bike in the garage, so I asked Helen to shift it.
Ah. Good thinking. See you.
All right. I've got a job.
If Paul rings, will you tell him I'm on my way? He said I'd help him out while he interviews applicants. Have they rung?
I can't risk it, Helen. I'm going to pay them.
But you can't.
I have to. I'm not going to lose Reese because of money.
Look, I know how much you love him, but you can't buy a baby, particularly not from these people. You'd never have a moment's peace of mind.
I'm so frightened. I wish I knew what Jim was going to do.
He's going to do what's best for all of you. Now trust him. I'll get. Hello, Helen Daniels speaking. Yes, she is. Just a moment, please.
Here you go.
Oh, I don't want anything till Melissa gets here, thanks.
It's all right. Have it while you're waiting. It's on the house.
Oh, Mr. Bishop gone out, right?
Yeah. It's all right, I'll make it up to him.
Okay, what's the catch?
Sorry?
Well, first you lend me this magazine, and then you give me a free milkshake. Why?
Todd, we're just friends. Nothing wrong with that, is there?
Well, you know, my mother told me never to accept gifts from older women. Especially when they're trying to find out what's on a certain motor scooter.
You rotten snake, you knew all the time, didn't you?
Yeah, but I don't know what Nick's design is, because they wouldn't show it to me.
Honest?
Hey, would I lie to you?
Yes, you would. And you can pay for that drink now because your girlfriend's here.
You said this was on the house.
Yes, but then I remember something too. My mother told me never to give gifts to young women. Hi, Melissa.
Hi. Could I have one of those?
Yeah, sure.
Sorry I took so long.
Oh, that's okay. Where have you been?
Picking up my last batch of American favourites.
Hey, can I have a look?
Later on. I haven't sorted through.
No, enough. Come on. Give us a
don't
look.
Talk.
Hey, these are... That one's great. Ben. Who's this?
Just a guy from school over there. Give him back.
Why has he got his arm around you? You were two-timing me.
Mr. Robinson wants the same order until the 21st of this month. month. Yes, and he said he's quite prepared to renegotiate them. Goodbye, Mr. Patton. Yes, I'll give him the message. Yes, goodbye. Jim, has Beverly told you?
Deborah and her boyfriend are due at the house between 1:30 and 2.
Yes.
Beverly's a nervous wreck.
Well, it's hardly surprising under the circumstances. She's terrified of losing Reese.
Well, that won't happen if I can help it. I don't suppose you can get away, could you? She could do with the support.
Well, you know I want to help, but Paul needs me here. He's interviewing job applicants and there's no one else to cover.
Ah, it's all right, it's all right. I'll do it myself. We just seem to make each other worse, that's all.
Well, Jim, I'm awfully worried. What are you going to do?
I'm going to make damn sure that Adam Delaney does not use that baby to extort money again, but I just hope to God I'm going the right way about it.
Please don't put yourself at risk. You see, I answered the phone when he called. He was enjoying himself. Oh, a man who'd sell his own child is capable of anything. He's subhuman, Jim.
Then I'll just have to treat him that way, won't I?
Oh, come on, Todd, be fair. At least let me explain.
I reckon the photos say it all.
Please. School's a lot different over there. There's things going on all the time. Football, rallies, and a school dance on almost every week. If you don't have someone to go to, you feel really left out. And my dad worked with his, it was just so much easier.
So you want me to believe that what was his name anyway?
Neil.
So this Neil character was just someone to go out with, was he?
Yes.
Oh, and when you got home from this rally or whatever you went to, you just shook his hand and that was it? Yeah, thought so.
It's no different than you and Cody.
I wasn't chasing Cody, she was chasing me.
Excuse me, guys, could you keep it down a bit? We're losing customers.
Sorry. And when you found out about Cody, you made me feel as if I'd just crawling out from under a rock or something.
I was only mad for a little while. And then when I thought about it because of what happened with me and Neil, I understood. I forgave you, didn't I?
Yeah, well, that's different.
Why can't you do the same for me?
Because you're a girl.
Oh, so it's okay for a guy to go behind his girlfriend's back, but when a girl does the same, it's slack, right?
Yeah.
You're the one that's slack, Todd. I don't even know why we got back together.
You all right, mate? Looks even better on the bike than it did on paper.
Honestly, you really like it?
Yeah, it's great. I mean, it's almost
amazing. I get the message.
You're
all right.
Best thing about it is it's original. Mm. You should go into business, man. You'd make a packet.
I'd be stupid.
Oh, I'm serious. Turn the streets of Australia into one giant art gallery.
Somehow I don't think the police would like me too much.
And sir, could you describe the bike that hit you?
Well, it was sort of a bluey colour with red stripes, green stripes, orange stripes, purple stars.
You hungry?
Starving.
Good. Well, what about we tidy up and get something to eat?
Okay. No, we'll wait till after lunch.
Fine. I'll shout you lunch at my place, huh?
All right.
Wish there was some way I could thank you.
Well, I'll settle for the odd ride now and then.
All right, it's yours.
And maybe, just maybe, I could use it in an art exhibition.
You'd have a bit of trouble, wouldn't you, getting it up on the wall?
Took your time, Doc.
Don't keep me waiting in future, all right?
All right.
Would you like a seat?
No, I would not. I would like to take the money and leave. Now, if we can just take care of business, I'll get out of your way.
Can you promise me this is the last time? I give you the money, I get Reese for good.
You're joking. We're on a good wicket here.
You know what you're doing is wrong. You are selling your own child.
You're making me sick, Doc. And the only cure is cash. So why don't you just make out your prescription and I'll go.
All right. But don't think this can go on forever. We just don't have the money to keep paying you.
You'll find it. Otherwise, Debs will apply to have your guardianship revoked. Those legal aid people are real helpful.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that. Because you're going to need them.
What? What's the matter?
Sorry, darling. Reese is safe.
You ran the twist, lady. She wanted to give us money. Deb reckons she got it into her head that we were going to take the kid away from her. Practically begged us.
That's not true. You know what he's done.
I'm sorry, Mr. Robinson, but I think your wife's been getting into the drug cabinet. I mean, women, they go a bit funny when they can't have babies, don't they?
You're wasting your breath, Delaney.
Oh, right, so you're going to believe them, are you?
No, no. No, I'm going to believe you. So I've heard every word you spoke in this room today. I think I've got a pretty clear idea of what happened. In other courts, now they don't take too kindly to blackmail and extortion, especially when a child's involved.
Out. You can forget about our baby. Deb's still his natural mother. She'll put him up for adoption before staying with you.
Sorry, Doug. It's all over now.
All over? Didn't you hear what he said? We're going to lose Reese.
Hmm. Well, I don't know what's wrong with these commercial artists. I mean, what don't they tell her when they see it? Come on.
Maybe I should make him my manager.
Well, I don't think that's a bad idea, really.
Anyway, I'm not going to worry about it. I'll get a job sooner or later.
Yeah. Well, why don't you forget about all the big studios and stuff and go for something else in the same field?
Like what?
I don't know, like cartoons, animation, that sort of stuff. You know what I mean? I mean, television, they use people to paint their sets, artists.
I think so, yeah. Anyway, you coming in?
No, man, I'm going to wait till Lee gets back. She won't be long.
Here she is.
Hello.
Nice choice. Which one's mine?
Neither, unless you tell me what you did to the scooter.
Right, well, I'm afraid you're going to have to ask Nick that. He is the artist.
I was blindfolded, remember?
Oh, look, I'm going to find out anyway.
Got to be better than that.
Oh, you creep. Oh, here, I might as well give you yours.
No, I'm right. I'm going to go for a swim first. You coming in?
No.
Why not? Come on, come in. It's beautiful. Relax. It's been a hard day.
Look, listen, mate, I might just stay here and drink one of these. But you go in. I'll join you later.
Suit yourself.
Have one of these. Melanie says they do wonders for a broken heart.
No, thanks.
Oh, dear. It really is serious, is it?
What do you reckon? Melissa was going out with that other bloke all the time she was away.
It's probably a perfectly innocent friendship.
Helen, I saw the photos. He had his arms around her and he was kissing her.
Well, can you blame him? Melissa's a very pretty girl.
Yeah, but she's supposed to be my girl. She was cheating on me.
Has it ever occurred to you that you were doing much the same thing with Cody?
That's different.
Can you tell me how?
Well, it wasn't my fault for one, and it's cool for a boy to be popular. A girl's supposed to stay faithful.
That is the most sexist remark I've ever heard.
Well, that's the way it is.
Look, you two were apart for a few months. Now, will you listen to me when I'm talking to you? You were both very lonely, so it was only natural that you'd find other friends. But it isn't the crime of the century.
What is when she does it?
You're being childish. Now, Melissa was very understanding about your situation with Cody. So I think if you want to patch up your friendship, that you should be showing the same maturity about this.
I'll behave yourself, will you? Just look after yourself.
You use your left foot more often. Oh, Steve-o.
If you ever lay a finger on her again, I personally will tear you apart.
There'll be no trouble, Tell. I promise you.
Of course it's kosher.
Of course it is. I think you lot have just convinced yourselves it's kosher.
All right, explain it then. If it's not kosher, explain how it was done.
Yeah, go on.
There, you can. I'll
tell you how it done. Look, it could have been ironed on, you know, like a transfer.
What? They put it over his body and then run an iron over it?
Well, anyhow, what does it matter whether it's kosher or not? It's like the Adolf Hitler diaries, isn't it? As long as something creates enough interest, it's an earner, right, well, Arthur?
Dave, that is a highly immoral... Oh, my God, look at this. Look, ash all over and all your grubby Oh, look, how can I exhibit that? I mean, have some respect.
Are you sure it was him?
No, I'm positive. On the other hand, of course, I suppose it could have been a ghost.
Cunning little toe rag, eh? Staged his demise to escape his creditors.
Not to mention the old Bill. He was in a jam sandwich.
Arthur's going to have all sorts of kittens.
Yeah, him. Him and the miracle of Hounslow, eh?
Shh, he's on his estate. Don't say a word. I can't wait to see his kipper.
Oh, hello. A double cyanide, yeah. A noose, and I'm relying on you to kick the chair away from under me, Dave.
What's up, Arthur? You look as white as a sheet.
You and all the others want hanging. It's all your fault. Sticky paws all over it, spilling your drink on it, fag ash all over it. A priceless religious artifact, lost to posterity for eternity.
You haven't lost it, have you, Arthur? Had it nicked? I mean, you was a bit Brahms last night.
No, I haven't lost it or had it nicked. I took it home with me last night and left it on a chair in the kitchen. When I came down this morning, her indoors had washed and ironed it. I don't see what's funny about it. You wouldn't have laughed if she'd washed the Mona Lisa, would you?
Well, it would wipe a smile off her face, wouldn't it?
Arthur, Terry has got some news for you.
Oh, yeah? What, I won the pools, have
I? No. I've just seen Larchie. In a police car.
Oh, Terry. Tell me you're at the wind-up.
It's no wind-up, Arthur. Terry was right all along. He was at the madam. You've been taken for a right bump up.
Well, it looks as if we've both been stitched up, Terry.
Yeah.
Me by Larchie, and you by your lady friend.
Yeah.
Well, my faith in human nature is totally destroyed. I'm so gutted I can top myself. And if I didn't have faith in him up there, that's exactly what I'd do.
I've got a letter from Marsden's Motors.
Oh. Well, fingers crossed, Terry.
So. Arthur! Look! Wait. They've offered me a job.
Oh. Well, I did have a word with them.
Did you?
Yeah.
Oh. Let's go and have a drink, eh?
After the news at 10, the City programme assesses the financial fiasco of local government swaps. The Square Mile faces losses of hundreds of millions and the latest fiscal implications of the Gulf War.
Plus analysis of today's latest indications of recession in the UK and why millions are facing more mortgage misery.
Don't miss the City's favourite financial programme live.
On BBC Two, the day's headlines and a review of the week's main stories in Newsview with Chris Lowe and Andrew Harvey. Good evening. The headlines tonight. President Saddam says he has no intention of pulling out of Kuwait before January the 15th. The Labour MP Tam Diel has told reservists to defy the government's call-up for the Gulf. And gales, whirlwinds and snow wreak more havoc across the country.
And the news this Christmas week. British troops in the Gulf celebrated in traditional style but continued the preparations for war. Storms on both sides of the world battered Britain and left a trail of devastation in Australia. And hundreds of homeless people came off the streets to find shelter and a Christmas dinner.
President Saddam Hussein has again rejected any idea of an Iraqi withdrawal from Kuwait before the mid-January deadline set by the Security Council. He and his senior officials met today and insisted Kuwait is a province of Iraq. But they still have not ruled out the chance of peace talks. They say it's up to the Americans to take the initiative. Tonight, the German foreign minister proposed a meeting with his European colleagues next Friday to discuss the crisis.
The Iraqi foreign minister Tariq Aziz emerged last night from a dinner here with his Yugoslav counterpart, who has a mandate from the non-aligned movement to mediate in the crisis, and found himself mobbed by cameras and reporters.
Have you given up all hope of discussions with the United States?
No, that depends on them. We have made our position very clear on that subject. We believe that each president has the right to fix the date of his meeting with the other foreign minister. If they accept that principle, then that matter would be solved.
So it is still possible, as far as you're concerned, that it's
talks to take place? It's up to the other side, you see, to make up its mind, you see.
But there's a feeling here that the Americans are no longer interested in a meeting and are not unhappy to see the idea of talks founder on the question of dates. As a result, Iraq is taking a tougher line than ever. A meeting of the Revolutionary Command Council today denied in the strongest terms suggestions in the West that Iraq might stage a big demonstration for peace shortly before the 15th of January deadline and then withdraw from Kuwait, using that as an excuse. The possibility existed only in the minds of evil planners, said a statement. And in an interview with Mexican television, recorded on Monday but shown here last night, President Saddam Hussein fiercely attacked the deposed ruling family of Kuwait and said they'd be allowed to return only as private citizens.
The Labour MP Tam Diel has said that medical reservists should defy their call-up for the Gulf. He said that by refusing to go, they could help draw back from the abyss of destruction. The Conservative MP Sir Nicholas Fairbairn said Mr Diel was asking the reservists to commit treason.
Before the House rose, Tam Diel was making clear his opposition to the government's Gulf policy, and not for the first time embarrassing the Labour leadership. Now he's saying that medical reservists should defy their call-up to the Gulf.
Parliament should be recalled to clarify the position that the purpose of the Territorial Army was morally the defence of these islands, and not to form part of what has become an Anglo-American expeditionary force on course for a horrendous war.
Labour's shadow cabinet won't thank Mr Diel for this contribution. Their policy has been to stick closely to the government's line, and this afternoon the party's foreign affairs spokesman Gerald Kaufman said it's proper for British forces in the Gulf to have the necessary skills appropriate to the situation, and if that requires the call-up of some reservists, this has to be accepted. Call-up papers are now on their way to nearly 400 reservists, and one Tory MP has accused Mr Diel of inciting them to commit treason, while another said it was an appalling piece of advice. But Mr Diel is not alone in his concern. This morning, Christian CND marched to Downing Street, calling on the government and America to give more time to sanctions.
Four Palestinians have been shot dead by Israeli soldiers in some of the worst clashes in recent months in the occupied Gaza Strip. It's estimated that as many as 250 people were injured in the violence. The trouble began in the refugee camp at Rafah when an army patrol fired on two masked activists who failed to stop. Bad weather is still affecting much of Britain. There were remarkable escapes in separate incidents in Wales. One family escaped unhurt when a thunderbolt hit and destroyed their home. And in Gosynon near Swansea, three streets were hit by a whirlwind.
The whirlwind struck in the middle of the night. It lasted only a minute, but it created havoc. 34 houses in three streets were damaged. Tiles torn from roofs were flung around like shrapnel, smashing through windows as residents lay asleep. One woman and her son had a lucky escape when a bedroom window shattered on top of them.
Our bed is under the window, and it just came in on top of me, and my little boy completely came in on top of us.
Cars inside garages were extensively damaged, and others outside were picked up by the wind and flung against.